get that place-based design correctly. The final thing I'll say, of course, is that we are in a position where things cannot stay the same. We are not as efficient as we should be. We do not provide the best of joined-up care, and I'm sure we all have examples, I do, from where I live, of where things are not well joined up, as well integrated as they should. And we do have a recruitment crisis where we cannot continue to recruit, for whatever reason, we cannot continue to recruit the numbers of staff we currently do operating in the current model. And therefore our encouragement is to support local places to design services that are fit for our current times within the resources that we have and with the constraints of our ability to recruit the very best of people. Our raison d'etre is to support you in developing that, not to get in the way. And everything we can do to support that, we will. I don't know, Castor, whether that in any way answers your question.
It's
but
very nice.
It's a start, I hope.
No, but thank you anyway.
Would you, the specifics you raised?
Well, there are specifics, and I think what the thing I would like to come back to really is I don't think we've had enough opportunity, given that this was a presentation of one, for us to really get into the meat of what the proposals are, and I would like another session on this. On the specifics of service, I'm happy to hear what has to be said on that.
I think it's important in terms of a sort of a distinction also that. The Cheshire Mersey Health and Care Partnership doesn't have a monopoly on transformation. So it isn't going to be the case that nothing happens until the partnership makes it happen. Of course, things need to happen, as they always have done, in relation to changes at a local level. But that's discrete and different to the role that we're talking about in relation to the things that need to happen at scale, perhaps once. It's entirely relevant to the discussions around place, but it is more of a local conversation. And Simon's maybe not now, but he's better placed to deal with some of those.
I can handle some of the specifics if that's okay, Chair. Phlebotomy, I think, is coming for the March agenda for scrutiny. A decision was made to return that service back to GPs, and we're just seeking assurance they're able to deliver that service. I'd like to get some more information from you outside the meeting, if that's a possible counsel, about the ultrasound issues, as we would probably have discussion with David's organisation about that. Musculoskeletal, no decision has been made on the future shape of the service, although most areas of the country actually now have physiotherapists triaging. What we've had really in the past is actually over-treatment in orthopaedics, so people having hip operation, knee operation, etc., too early in their life, because if you have one in your 30s or 40s or close to 50s, you're more likely to need one later. So the idea is to keep people, again, well for longer. Again, in the spirit of our hope, you know, I've tried to work with this group in the last few months, is we're happy to bring that service model with you to have a discussion. IAPT has been to scrutiny before, and I'm hoping it's on the agenda again for future reference. IAPT is improving access to psychological therapies. We do have a provider who's not meeting the needs of the population, and we are having to have a provider for that service. However, we need to do so in a way that, again, works with our local voluntary organisations, with our local providers and local people, because the service we've currently commissioned is very medically focused and doesn't create social resilience in people. And finally, in terms of having a strategy to commission, believe it or not, in many areas there's nothing off the shelf. There's no plans that we can immediately bring to you because we have to develop them. However, what we have circulated is a draft commissioning strategy. And that commissioning strategy, again, we've asked to be put on the scrutiny agenda going forward so you can have a view of it as a committee. That sets out the direction of travel, and from that will fall out a series of plans, which, as we're doing with urgent care and our pre-consultation work on that, we want to have events actually working with local people to develop what that actually looks like in practice. So the commitment to the scrutiny committee from ourselves as the local CCG, the local commissioners, to keep that dialogue open with you, to bring the papers as they develop, and certainly we've had a dialogue today on another issue around care homes between ourselves and the chair, which we'll keep you appraised of as we go as well.
Thank you. I'm going to take David, Tony, and Phil, please.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good evening. Good evening to you. I've looked at your presentation quite closely, and I can see where you've come from. It almost sort of has a feel of a matrix management with a bit of a balance scorecard in the corner, and it, you know, I can see where you're going with it. But I think the concern, and it was certainly raised by Councillor Proctor, that I'm just slightly worried that we're going ahead here without any of the granularity that I think we need. Whether that was a report, whether that was additions to your, it's all very strategic. And bearing in mind the people in this room, on both sides of this room, have got to effectively sell what you're trying to offer. It would be very, very helpful if we had something that gave us some of the rudiments of what it's going to be like for the service user. Now, sadly, I'm a long-term user of the NHS, and I'd like to know personally. So if I use my own situation, I would like to know what exactly is going to change at the point of delivery. All of this that we're seeing here now is very useful, but I worry that on that last slide, I can see across the top around the duties that it has public consultation. I would have liked to have seen how that public consultation is going to be delivered, because the next one is implementation. And I think the real worry that we probably all have in this room is we don't want the next meeting you to have gone further down the route of implementation, and we're sort of waving, hoping that you're going to notice us. Because it's definitely worth engaging the people in this room, not only for their thoughts, but also for their ability to try and sell the sizzle of what it is that you're trying to do. And I think you've missed that trick, if I'm being honest. I mean, it makes me wonder, Madam Chair, whether in fact this meeting has any further value today until we have some more granularity.
I think we're here now, David, and I think there are quite a few people with some questions, so we will continue. I can see Val wants to come back on that, please.
No,
sorry.
It's all right, don't worry. I just want to bring it back to Wirral. I'm a GP and have been on Wirral for 31 years, people I see in front of me, I don't know how many thousands of consultations, hundreds of thousands of consultations that is, but I see many people where both health and care, social care, are issues for them. So to me, the integration in terms of that we're working on, we're all in terms of bringing social and health together, is absolutely right for the people that I see in front of me, and you must speak to too. The other divide that makes no sense to me is the way that the NHS started as twins, separated at birth, because primary and secondary care were always separate. And then we have community and mental health separate. That doesn't make any sense to an individual that's in front of us. That's one person. So the work that is being done to integrate care makes huge sense to me as a GP. And I feel that going back to the 80% of this is about what happens on Wirral. I think the healthy Wirral work that we're working on together, that aligns with the 20 pledges, that allows us to bring integration together, alive on Wirral, is absolutely the right direction to go in. And of course, as items from that suggest different ways of doing things, of course that should be a matter of public consultation as appropriate and a matter of scrutiny. But we need to be aware that the majority of what we're talking about is healthy rural work. I'd also like to say, though, from a clinical angle, some things should not need to be sort of looked at 12 times across Cheshire and Mersey. An example that has happened already is one of the work streams is about neurology, about brains. And a new headache pathway was looked at by experts around that area, and that's been taken on board by clinicians on Wirral as an improved way to look after people with headaches. So that sort of work is assisting clinicians on Wirral to help patients get the right services for them without having to reinvent it too many times. But that sort of work, which I think is really important, may not be appropriate for public consultation. I'm sure, you know, is it right to scrutinise the best way to look after clinically somebody with headaches? But we're getting great advantage from working with colleagues across the patch. So I just felt from a clinical angle it'd be worth highlighting those areas that could be helpful.
So, just to reinforce, I was not trying to be a doctor.
No.
So I was just with the strategic bit that I was interested in.
Okay, Tony,
Thank you.
For me, it's about trust. And my role as a scrutiny officer, you know, I'm hearing and we see that SDPs and ACOs and all these other terms that we have, which seem to change by the week or by the month, it's so complicated, it's very difficult to understand, hence the chair asking for further meetings and so forth. And that, I'm hearing that there's Stephen Hawkins taking yourselves, SDPs and ACOs and the whole area of that to judicial review. You've already said you haven't got the legitimacy to deliver an SDP or an ACO. Us as a council certainly haven't taken part in any of that process. We're very much at arm's length and don't want to be part of that because of reasons that were said regarding us taking part into something that could do our people a lot of harm. I mean, one of them areas is about, and this is what I'm hearing from different groups that I engage with, you're making the platform ready for an American type health service because you've already admitted that there's no resources in there. You just said, you know, where are you going to get the resources from? The government's not going to give you any more resources, even though the people won't pay for a health service. That was seen in the general election. People want to pay more money for a national health service. You bring things down to the local level. This is a national health service that the people on my left and the people who we represent are fighting to maintain, which is free at the point of delivery. So what we're looking for from a scrutiny point of view is to understand exactly what you're talking about, to reflect back to you what you mean by there's going to be a big financial gap and who's going to fill that financial gap. Is that going to come through a different system where people have to pay insurance to fill that gap? You know, is the crisis that we've got at the moment regarding, we're told by the government, there's loads more nurses, there's loads more doctors, you've recruited loads more people into the NHS. So we're getting all these different conflicting messages. We're getting one from the government, we're getting one from yourselves, we're getting one from...
Another question, please.
Yeah, it's coming up. It's one from other groups like Save Our NHS and the pressure groups that their understanding is that's what is happening. So as a scrutiny officer, I need a lot more detail from every side of the argument. And to be honest with you, I'd like to see the results of the judicial review before I engage with anything to do with any of that.
Councillor, thank you. You will recognise that we, as public servants, do not have any hold over the amount of money that comes into the system. And I would not disagree with you at all that the system, both in health and in local government, circles is that financial position is extremely tight and getting to a point of being dangerous. But we are at a position where what we try to do is to recognise that we have a finite set of money, we have a finite set of resources, and not enough of those as well in terms of people, and to make the best out of that we can, both by doing things at scale at the partnership level, but trying to enable local places to actually decide how it best spends the money that there is, the limited amount of money it is. One of the things I did when I first came on patch in July was to meet with every local authority chief officer. And I think Graham will agree, I think I met with him within 2 weeks of me being on patch. Because I recognised that one of the failings was that we had not had that engagement. So I'm committed to that engagement and that discussion. I think I can speak for Mel that neither she nor I would look to any sort of privatisation of the NHS wholesale on our watch. It would not happen. So I would resign tomorrow if that was where I thought we were taking. You have my assurance on that. And if that changes because of any government policy, I will be back here like a shot to let you know.
So what you're saying is we need to get rid of this government so we can get more finance. Absolutely,
you know I'm not saying that. Yeah. Yeah.
Not political,
remember.
If we can just
Pass
the next, and then Christina, please,
and Adrian. Thank you, Chair. When the Georgia Council took a principled stand on a resolution in December 2016, expressed its concern about the failure of consultation with elected members, so I hope we're addressing that. It also was concerned about public participation, so I think we may be getting somewhere on that. The third element of concern was the question of what we described as far-reaching changes to the configuration of hospitals in the acute sector. And the resolution went on to talk about what was then seen as the 908 million gap. Now, the document which you're now telling us perhaps overtaken by events in terms of structure, I'm looking at the 15th of November issue from 2016, version 4.4 of the Sustainability and Transformation Plan. It's not clear to me whether this has ended up in some dustbin, or whether elements of it are being carried forward. Because in that document, there were sections about Cheshire and World, the Alliance, and various plans, and various strategic thoughts were put together, which may be happening somewhere else. You've very kindly given us, as Dr. Wells is describing, information about local services, local primary services, and how to cope with small headaches. What I'm interested in is the big headache, if any else, the big sort of thumping headache that causes the citizens of Wirral and other places to wonder about what might happen in future years if we don't get things stable in some form. As Councillor Norbury has mentioned, it's a question of funding. Various parties have various ideas about money on income tax or other schemes that might emerge, but at the moment we are where we are with some great big hammer to people in the higher echelons, which says, what are you doing to achieve these targets, the 908 million? So we're very pleased to talk, I think, Chair, about what's happening here, detailing the ground, work together to design things that our citizens will make great use of, the integration that we've been talking about for probably 3 or 4 years and now nothing happened. But it is those bigger things that are at the back of our mind that trouble this committee. And as Councillor Brockman says, there's a clear procedure that when big things, and I'm calling big things without having a proper title, but changes to acute services or the location of things or the merger of a large unit, specialisms, those things are probably circling above us in these meetings that you said might take place every 6 months. Because the document very kindly gave us talked about changes to scope, and annual allocations, assurances of progress. And in the four columns on the final slide, the purple, green, red and blue ones, each one of those had a box where it was out of scope. So, with respect, that work that's described as out of scope, produced perhaps, is in somebody else's scope. And we'd like to know what's going on there as well, please.
So I think I've alluded to, and I know that Andrew has, about the desire, the need, the expectation that people have of receiving high quality healthcare when they need it, as locally as it is possible to safely deliver that. Now we are, none of us are strangers to a concept, particularly in a city like Liverpool, which is pretty unique actually in its construct of the specialisation that exists around certain disease groups. And for many years that has been held up as a very important feature of the landscape of the health care delivery system across Cheshire and Merseyside. So the specialisation that happens around Liverpool Heart and Chest, around the Walton Centre, which Dr. Wells has alluded to in terms of the work stream on neurosciences, our cancer centres and our children's centres, is an important distinction that we would recognise exists within our patch. But there is an issue around the lack of parity in many respects that exists, because if you live near those centres, you might get a different sort of proposition. You might be able to access care of a different standard, of a higher standard in some respects. You might be able to get into a centre that is recognised nationally or even internationally as a centre of excellence. But what if you live a long way away from those centres? What do you do then? So one of our propositions, and the work streams that you will see on the right-hand side that I didn't go into very much detail about, you will see they are cancer, they are neurosciences, they are children's services, and they are cardiovascular services. And what we want to create is a system where the offer to the people of Wirral in the area of all those specialties is of the same standard as you would receive if you happen to live in the house next door to one of those specialist centres. And we will do that by creating a network of providers working together for a common set of standards and procedures, a little like the pathway for headache that Dr. Wells has described, so that we can ensure that the patients who need to end up in those specialist centres, when they need to end up in them, do. But for everything else, they receive as much care as possible in the local setting. That's an important feature of our approach to acute reconfiguration. The other driver is the issue that I highlighted when I presented about people's desire to receive 24-hour care, so that the standard of care and the availability of expert clinicians is the same at 2 a.m. on a Sunday morning as it is at 11 a.m. on a Monday morning. And we cannot continue to provide all the services in every location that we currently do to that standard on a 24-hour, 365-day-a-year basis with the workforce that we currently have. So there is a need to recognise that and to look at how we can reconfigure those services and strengthen the resilience of them so that it really doesn't matter what time of day you present to those services, you are guaranteed the best possible intervention with the best possible outcome. And I think anyone who has had a severe head injury or a massive cardiac event and has been able to access those specialised services or a particularly challenging cancer procedure will recognise that there is an intricate balance to be struck between what it is appropriate to deliver locally and what it is better to travel as short a distance as we can make that to receive that care.
Just picking up Councillor Gilchrist, you had a couple of other points in there. The things that are out of scope are the things that statutory, because Andrew said that this is not a statutory body, but it's comprised of statutory bodies. So if there is a decision to be made on a service reconfiguration, clearly it has to go through the process that recruiting members will be familiar with, in terms of a five-stage, actually, now assurance process and making sure scrutiny are aligned with it. But if there is a decision that needs to be made around healthcare beyond Wirral, we have to form committees in common across clinical commissioning groups. And that's what's referred to in the outer scope. So clinical commissioning groups are having to have discussions about, as the recommendations come out, as recommendations are shared with you around neuroscience, CVD and so on, how do we make the decisions about them with our own local hats on, but also recognising that some of that impact is beyond our local borough borders. So Councillor Gilchrist, in his declarations of interest, mentioned that he's involved in Cheshire Rural Partnership. They provide services to Wirral residents locally, but they also provide services to Wirral and Cheshire residents, such as secure inpatient beds, certain learning disability services on a far bigger scale, because you need to do those sort of services at scale. The other thing is about the financial gap that you mentioned. The financial gap exists if you do nothing. It's a do-nothing gap. It's the gap between increasing demand, the cost of increasing demand, and the projected income. We have had better financial settlement this planning round, the 18-19 planning round, and I'm happy to share the information about the 18-19 planning round with scrutiny members through the chair in the next couple of days, certainly for a lot of the Friday, which gives you an overview of what's in there. But the gap is if you do nothing. So if we deliver the Wirral pledges around healthy Wirral, if we integrate health and care, if we reduce over-treatment and waste, we start to chip away at some of that gap. We start to affect some of that gap. And that's what we are, I suppose, tasked to do, working with the people who work in the services, the clinicians, the service managers, but also the people who use the services. Because we certainly, the programme I'm leading, Women's and Children's, has a massive evidence base behind it in terms of the National Maternity Services Review, but also is being applied locally. And I think you're very fortunate in Wirral to have one of the top five in the country maternity units in terms of this data CQC rating. Certainly one of the five best in the north, and three of those are in Cheshire and Wirral. So there's a lot of work that actually is going on that is about improving healthcare, delivering better outcomes for people, because if you improve healthcare and reduce, get it right first time essentially, you start to address some of the issues around finance. Because I think of the figures about 80% of the maternity care currently goes on the insurance payment. So the less harm we do, the less insurance we have to pay, the better the service to the patient, the more money we put back into those services.
Thank you, Sam. We've still got a number of speakers, though. Christina first, then Adrian. I've got Leslie, Wendy, and Paul.
Thank you.
I just have to say that the more you've all spoken, the more confused I am about what you're talking about. I can't understand the point you're making over centres of excellence, because my husband's very lucky, he goes to the Walton Centre and has done for many years under Ralph Eldridge. We see people from across the divide there. Nobody's unhappy about coming. Everybody who I've ever met in the Walton Centre is delighted to be there because of the fantastic service that we get there. So I don't understand why you would tell me that somebody who lives next door is more likely to get there than who lives by Clatterbridge. Perhaps I misunderstood. But quite a few of the other things confuse me. You talk about delivering a vision as if it's something to be proud of. And then what? And then we have it here in the next breath. Well, there isn't any money and this is why we're doing it. So tell me, it's just a yes-no answer now. If you had more money, would you be delivering this particular vision? That's what I want to know.
Yes.
Yes.
Good, but I hope you stand by that.
For the reasons I gave about clinical care needing to be integrated with social care and primary and secondary care working together.
So you're quite happy to deliver this vision that you have given us for the people of Wirral? You all feel it's a very good vision, not dependent on the money that you are being given at all. That's the question I asked.
I said yes, and I said yes because the NHS Constitution. And the NHS Constitution states the NHS belongs to us all, staff, patients, people, taxpayers. It also has in it a set of standards around access to psychological therapies, referral for treatment times, A&E waiting times and so on, that at the moment, as we are working as a system, we are not meeting. So unless we work better together, we don't deliver the NHS Constitution, we don't deliver those standards, and we don't deliver the pledge that has been made to the people by Parliament around that constitution.
The question I asked you was, if you had more money, would this be your vision?
And the answer is the same because of the NHS constitution. The more money still does not negate the need to work better together. Absolutely, I fully agree with you.
That would be the question we still want to
find. Absolutely, I fully agree with you on that.
Thank you. Adrian, please.
Well, Chair, first of all, let me apologise. I'm just an old history teacher, and I found this terribly difficult to deal with, partly because a lot of it was too small for me to read the print, and more importantly, because I do like to have a narrative before me if I'm going to try to understand anything. So I would like to think that we could reconvene this meeting, but we do have a narrative, and we'd be able to speak, all of us, from a more informed basis. But it seems to me that the problem with what's happening here in Wirral at the moment is that it can mean either of two things. The amalgamation of services under financial pressure, irrespective of what you say, it seems to me to be a function of the government's stringent financial policy. And there are strident voices in saying that our council should have nothing to do with it. But you can't walk away from it when it's happening, because that would simply mean the collapse of existing services, and something has to be done. But secondly, there are also strong voices saying that this is not what we want to do under the particular government that we have, although a similar amalgamation of services is what we would want under a very different sort of government, because we would expect a different sort of government not to lead this in the direction of privatisation, whereas the result of what's happening now could open the door to privatisation, whether any of us on this table want it or not, under the government that we can have. That's where there'd be some problems between us. It seems to me that we Wirral is facing the short-term necessity of facing a very cleverly crafted device by the government to direct us, to almost herd us into establishing a framework for the same sort of privatisation as already happened in the GP surgeries. And they've done it in such a way that it makes it almost impossible for us to not do something of that sort, because otherwise we wouldn't have the amalgamation of services that people on this side of the table would really want. Because under a different government, it would be right to re-establish it with that framework already having put in place for something which is far more in the tradition of the National Health Service than the direction we fear it will go into under the government that we have. Now, I realise that my old friends on the other side of the table who say I'm talking absolute nonsense, and that we can be safe to this government because they have already promised us that there will never be another top-down reorganisation. That's the end of the story. That was a promise. I think my final point is that I'm glad to have it explained. I would like to have it better explained, please. I do want a narrative so I can understand it. Because it seems to me that irrespective of what you said, I do expect civil servants to say, we will do what's good, because the same thing, the same tool, the same gun can be pointed in either direction. And this is a reorganisation which could lead to the sort of privatisation that perhaps a different political complexion from mine would want, or it's the sort of reorganisation which would fall exactly into what my party wants. From your point of view, you're neither here nor there because you're civil servants and you simply have to do it.
Yeah.
Well, I think that, and I will make a political point now, although
we're
not political again.
I think
a Labour government, if there is a lot of this privatisation, will just take it straight back into the National Health Service.
Councillor, the risk of repeating myself, and apologies again for the lack of documentation and paper for this, and we will rectify that. Luckily, I am not a civil servant. I am not employed by government, and I am here because I think that Cheshire and Merseyside as a conurbation needs to do better in the way in which we better integrate and get the best out of the limited money that we have.
I was only recognising your impartiality.
coming on to one of the previous questions around would we be doing this, I think whatever complexion of government we have, there would be a desire to better integrate services. And we've tried this many, many times before, and we've not succeeded particularly well, and we now have another chance of trying to do that. We failed to get that off the ground by the lack of engagement of local authorities in the first round of this a year or so ago, and we hope we're putting that right now, because this is not just about health services, it's not just about the social care services that we're trying to integrate with us from local authority. It is about prevention, it is about education, it is about housing, it is about the ability for people to access the services that they need for their lives in the best way and most efficient way possible. And the way in which the discussions are going on here and in other places is around trying to create those neighbourhood environments where those services can be joined up properly. I don't think anyone on either side of this table would want to do less. If we had more money, we could do it faster, we could provide a fuller range of services, we could find more services. But we would still be trying to do integration, work better, make services more efficient. So I honestly don't think we are loggerheads. We have the same aims in what we're trying to do. And if I thought for one minute that this was about setting up integration that was a precursor to privatisation, I would be running back to my fells with the dog.
Thank you, Andrew. We now have Leslie, Wendy, Arthur. Thank you, Chair. It's interesting to hear Mr. Gibson say, and clearly the politics can be easily taken out of it, as you've just alluded to the fact that it isn't a precursor to privatisation, and also you would be doing this anyway, whichever government have got out of it. Can I just go back to the start again, and I do apologise, you know, if this is getting repetitious now, but there has been no report here.
And I feel, I do have to say, if we're going to work in partnership, we have to feel as if we are equal partners. And I do get the feeling, to be quite honest, that it's a little bit feeling of them, yourselves, and us, and we are the poor relation. I hope that's not the case, because we are still smarting from the incident that we had in, a couple of committees ago, where we were talking about the closure of ours at Easton. And again, here we are again, and the promises, and you know, I'm not doubting you by any means, talking promises again, that you know, we will be, we will get a report. The document in front of us tonight is a public document, because we are meeting in public. And again, you know, I'm repeating myself now, because if a member of the public were to pick up this, you know, I don't think any of us in this room, the members of the public ourselves, none of us are stupid, but it is extremely difficult to understand and read. And we say this at nigh on most of our meetings, really, that the jargon has to come out of it. And I know that's difficult, because you're trying to explain such an intimate service. And cannot be easy, but it has to be able to be picked up and read by a member of the public as well. So we do want to work in partnership. We've been begging to work in partnership, particularly under the banner of the integration of health and social care. And it is a real hobby horse of mine, as well as obviously all the other services that health provide. But our chief executive was appointed here quite some years ago now, and Mr. Gibson, you said that on your first day you met with him, and I'm sure Eric Robinson spoke to you about his experience that he'd had in his previous authority, where he had been quite one of the main movers and shakers of bringing integrated social care and health together. I feel that we are still a long way away from that here. And one of the points I make, and you know, I'm sorry for poor people, is that when a person presents, and we're calling them participants now, I don't know if they like that or not, but that's immaterial at this point. But when a person presents, particularly an older person who might be confused, is clearly worried and is clearly of ill health, to any one of our professional services, they are sent on a merry-go-round of people who are going to be hopefully involved in their future care. I think we've wasted a number of years quite clearly with what's gone on from 2004. And all the time while that is being wasted, there are older people particularly who are ill, sick, as I said before, who are in this system, and they have to talk to a myriad of professionals. How far are we off, and how long will it be until we can say that people, when they present with those complications, that they only have to tell their story only once to one professional? I mean, if we can keep that out of all this, all the jargon that's in here, in the back of our minds, I mean, really, that is something which should be a major aspiration. Could I just ask as well, this is the 18-19 scope. What is going to be the timescale for you coming back here and reporting into us, hopefully with a report presented beforehand? Where do we go from tonight? Clearly a number of members have said that they want another meeting to discuss where we're up to at this stage. But you know, if we go from 18 to 19 and we still haven't moved forward in huge leaps, then clearly everybody's going to be disappointed, but more so than that is the people of Wirral are not going to be benefiting from the service they so rightly deserve. So and I'd love to come to if those meetings where you have 150 people from all these other organisations and the professionals that are